Thank you for joining us today. I'm Carla Ellard, curator of the Fotografía Collection, and we're honored to celebrate the photography of Rodrigo Moya with his first retrospective exhibition in the United States of his career. We are also honored to present the new book titled Rodrigo Moya, Photography and Conscience, which is the first English-Spanish bilingual monograph to be published in the world about him.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
It is the 17th volume in the Wittliff Southwestern and Mexican Photography Series, published by the University of Texas Press. For my part, my role as volume editor, there are several people to thank and recognize, starting with our founding donors, Bill and Sally Wittliff. From Texas State University, our Associate Vice President and University Librarian, Joan Heath. Director of the Wittliff Collections, Dr. David Coleman. David is the editor of the Southwestern and Mexican Photography Series, and together with Bill and David, we work together in addition with the Moyas, to somehow try to edit his vast archive into the prints you see on the wall and in the book. So it was a great experience for me, and I'd like to thank them for that incredible experience. Connie Todd, who couldn't join us today, but served as, really was essential to the translation process. This book is bilingual, and she translated every word, which was originally written in Spanish. And so I thank her for her assistance. And then I'd also like to recognize Ariel Arnal, who's joined us today. And Ariel wrote the essay that's featured in the book. And I think he's here today from the University of Texas Press, the book designer, Derek George. Yes, yes, there he is. Thank you. This afternoon, Rodrigo will be presenting in Spanish, and his wife, Susan Flaherty, will be translating. Actually, yesterday, Rodrigo and Ariel have signed all of the books already, so if you purchase your book and would like it personalized or inscribed, they will be doing that after the program. And it's a real pleasure to introduce Rodrigo and Susan, because this has been a two-year journey to get to this point, and so I thank them for just a great experience. Susan Flaherty received her Bachelor of Arts Honors degree in Art and Design from Bath Academy of Art. Moving to Mexico in 1978, Susan worked as a graphic designer and illustrator for both advertising agencies and editorial groups. She was illustrator and editorial designer for Técnica Pesquera, where she worked with Rodrigo Moya, who was director of the magazine. And to make a long story short, they've been married for 34 years. Yes. And Susan is the coordinator of Rodrigo's photographic archive and manages all aspects of the collection, from preservation to exhibitions. Rodrigo Moya is a prominent Mexican documentary photographer who began as a photojournalist in 1955. He covered the convulsive period that shook Latin America during the 1950s and 60s, including the guerrilla movements in Guatemala and Venezuela, the invasion of Santo Domingo, and the Cuban Revolution. Acclaimed for his social photography, his photographs are often charged with political ideology. Rodrigo abandoned photography in 1967 to take advantage of his experience as a journalist, dedicating himself to writing and editorial projects. In addition to writing about his experiences as a photographer, Rodrigo is an award-winning author of short fiction. His photography is receiving renewed attention and acclaim, and he recently received the Espejo de Luz Award for his photographic career. Please join me in welcoming Susan and Rodrigo.
I'm just going to make a short, hopefully short, introduction before Rodrigo makes his introduction, so it'll be two introductions today. Good afternoon to everyone here. I just wanted to say a few words before we get down to the serious stuff with Moya. Firstly, our deepest thanks for the formidable invitation given to Rodrigo to present both an exhibition of his work and the creation of a beautiful book here in the Wittliff Collections under the University of Texas Press. This was proposed towards the end of 2013, and it seemed then that the autumn of 2015 was a lifetime away. The respect and details regarding our opinions in this whole and complicated process was truly astonishing. Between Carla, Connie and I, we must have exchanged hundreds and hundreds, even thousands, I think, of emails. Well, thankfully, there's email and it's not just telephone nowadays. All important and constructive. Connie working with such dedication on the translations. The nuances of the Spanish to English, I think, gave us many a gray hair. And with Carla present at every moment of the work, nothing passing her eagle eye. Speaking for us both, our sincere thanks to Bill and Sally Wittliff, David Coleman, Carla Ellard, Connie Todd, Michelle Miller, and last but not least, the UT Press and their designer, Derek George. Thank you, Derek. On the other side of the border, enormous thanks to Ariel Arnau for his scrupulous and so enjoyable essay. I also wanted to add that this isn't my first time here. I had the fortune to come for the collective exhibition in August 2005, Testigos de la Historia, Witnesses to History, and where one of Rodrigo's images was the invitation photo, Monumento a la Revolución. I was overwhelmed at the warmth everyone showed, Bill and Sally, Carla, Connie and Michelle. It was a truly memorable visit and I really loved Austin. And I'm really glad to be back again. Finally, I'd like to mention that Rodrigo has a serious problem with his sight due to damage to the optic nerve. As he says, he sees the world out of focus and with a tarnished lens. But this is his world.
I think it's not necessary to learn to say this same this lo mismo if he say in English.
You read.
But if you want, I read in Spanish.
He's already started arguing.
Sí.
There we are.
Sí. Buenas tardes a todos.
Buenas tardes.
Sé que la palabra agradecimiento casi siempre preside este tipo de actos. Como muchas palabras, estas pierden su sentido en circunstancias extraordinarias o de tanto repetirse. Y para mí, esta reunión viene al caso. Este día se trata de una situación fuera de lo común y agradecimiento es poco. Quiero sustituirla por palabras más sentidas y verdaderas para mí. Quiero decir contento, alegría, felicidad.
Good afternoon, everybody. I know that the words thanks and appreciation generally begin this type of presentation. As with many words, these lose their meaning in extraordinary circumstances. And for me, this reunion is one of them. Today is not an ordinary day, and my appreciation means little. I'd like to substitute this for words with more feeling and truth for me. I'd like to say contentment, joy, happiness.
De verdad que es un contento estar aquí con ustedes, con personas que no me conocen, aunque ya encontré muchas conocidas, y en cuya lengua no puedo comunicarme, problema que les evitará mi esposa Susan Flaherty, que tras 34 años de casados no ha podido introducir en mi dura cabeza su inglés, que para mayor complicación es británico. Debo decir que ella fue la columna que soportó el mayor peso del proceso del libro y la exposición en su faceta mexicana. Sus ojos sustituyeron mis ojos deteriorados y mi inglés balbuciente. Sin su amor al proyecto, paralelo al de Carl Art, el ritmo de viejo dinosaurio no habría servido mucho.
I'm truly content to be here with you today, with people who don't know me and with whom I can't easily communicate. A problem which will be resolved by Susan Flaherty, who, after 34 years of marriage, hasn't been able to get English into my hard head. This wasn't part of the marriage contract, sir. And which, to make it more complicated, is British. I must say that... sin comentario. I must say that she was the support that took the weight of the books and exhibitions process on the Mexican side. Her eyes were the substitute for my deteriorated eyes and my stuttering English. Without her love for the project parallel with Carla Ellard, my rhythm of an old dinosaur wouldn't have been of much use.
Mis profundas gracias a Ariel Arnal, historiador de la fotografía chileno-mexicano, con quien pasamos muchas horas escarbando solamente en el archivo, pero también en mi vida. A veces una tarea cuesta arriba, pero siempre divertida.
My profound thanks to Ariel Arnal, Mexican-Chilean photographic historian, with whom we passed many hours delving not only into the archive, but also my life, at times an uphill task, but always enjoyable.
Verlos reunidos aquí solidariamente, solo para ver parte de mi obra, me da mucha alegría, que es más que contento, y me da también, de verdad, una enorme felicidad, que es más que contento y alegría juntas.
To see you all here, to have your support and interest to see some of my work gives me joy, which is more than contentment, and also gives me great happiness, which is more than contentment and joy together.
Así que la Wittliff Collections, Bill y Sally Wittliff, el director David Coleman y la curadora Carla Ellard, la traductora, qué pena que no está aquí, Connie Todd, tanto con la Universidad de Texas Press, y mis gracias especiales a su diseñador, Derek George, y el trabajo conjunto de quienes conocieron, hicieron posible esta exposición y el hermoso libro Fotografía y Conciencia, que son causa de esos sentimientos que hoy me llenan plenamente. Contento, alegría, felicidad. Gracias a todos.
In this way, the Wittliff Collections, Bill and Sally Wittliff, the director David Coleman and curator Carla Ellard, the translator Connie Todd, together with the University of Texas Press, with special thanks to their designer Derek George, and the collective work of all who made possible this exhibition and beautiful book, Fotografía y Conciencia, are the cause of these sentiments that today fill me with contentment, joy, and happiness. Thank you to everyone.
Nací en Colombia en 1934. Hijo de padre mexicano y madre colombiana. Ella con 17 años de edad cuando yo nací. Dos años después, con el agregado de una hermanita de brazos, mis padres regresaron a México, donde desde entonces he vivido siempre.
I was born in Colombia in 1934, the son of a Mexican father and Colombian mother, who was 17 years old when I was born. 2 years later, with the addition of my sister in her arms, my parents returned to Mexico, where I've lived ever since.
Soy, según las leyes mexicanas, mexicano por nacimiento, aunque me gusta sentirme latinoamericano. Mi padre fue un talentoso escenógrafo de teatro que fue llamado al cine mexicano en su época de oro.
I'm considered, according to Mexican law, Mexican by birth, although I like to feel myself as Latin American. My father was a talented stage designer and entered Mexican cinema in its golden age, the height of its popularity.
Por esta circunstancia, mi primera infancia transcurrió rodeado de personas del mundo artístico, pintores, escritores, poetas y desde luego actores y bohemios de todos los estilos. Mi madre se adaptó pronto al ambiente mexicano, pero no abandonó sus raíces ni costumbres colombianas y la casa familiar fue durante años una especie de embajada alterna de Colombia en México.
Due to this, my early infancy passed surrounded with people from the art world, painters, writers, poets, and of course actors, plus bohemians of all types. My mother adapted quickly to the Mexican way of life, but never abandoned her roots or customs, and our home for years was a kind of alternate Colombian embassy.
En esa atmósfera conviví con imágenes de todos tipos, pintura, grabados y libros de arte. Además, mi madre era una tenaz aficionada a la fotografía y en los frecuentes paseos de campo con amigos o paisanos nunca olvidaba su camarita de fuelle. Más tarde, traté por primera vez a Gabriel García Márquez, que antes de ser alcanzado por la fama, frecuentaba esas reuniones y con el tiempo hicimos una amistad distante pero firme.
In this atmosphere, I was conscious of images, paintings, engravings, and art books. Also, my mother was an enthusiastic amateur photographer, and in the frequent days in the country or with her Colombian friends, never forgot her bellows camera. Later on, it was here at these get-togethers that I met for the first time Gabriel García Márquez, before he became famous, and over time we formed a friendship, distant but firm.
Ese mundo pletórico de ideas y polémicas en apariencia apenas me rozó. Mi naturaleza era inquieta, me empujaba a la acción. Fui Boy Scout, disfrutaba de las excursiones y después del montañismo. Me atraían los juegos fuertes como el high alley, el frontenis y más tarde el buceo.
This artistic atmosphere, full of discussions and arguments, hardly touched me. My restless temperament pushed me towards action. I was a Boy Scout and loved excursions into the country and later on mountaineering. I was attracted to games like high alley, fronton and later on diving.
Terminé el bachillerato como interno en una universidad militar en donde ponía más atención a los deportes que al rigor académico. Sin embargo, en 1972 fui admitido en la Facultad de Ingeniería en la Universidad de México con el sueño de verme como un ingeniero petrolero explorando las selvas mexicanas, una especie de Indiana Jones tecnócrata, pero esto se derrumbó ante la batalla perdida contra las matemáticas y el cálculo integral.
I finished senior high school at a military college, where for me sports were more important than academic rigor. Nevertheless, in 1952, I was admitted to the engineering faculty at the University of Mexico with the dream of being a petroleum engineer, exploring the Mexican jungle, a kind of Indiana Jones technocrat. But this all collapsed due to my lost battle with mathematics and integral calculus.
Abandoné la facultad en 1954 y quedé a la deriva en el mundo, angustiado por la decepción causada a mis padres y la falta de una perspectiva válida ante la vida. Hice un curso de televisión y logré graduarme, pero no me gustó el ambiente y no quise seguir esa ruta. Inesperadamente, fue la fotografía que me salvó de la incertidumbre de mi futuro.
In 1954, I abandoned the faculty and found myself adrift in the world, grieved at the deception caused to my parents, and facing life with the lack of a valid perspective. I did take and complete a television course, but not liking the atmosphere, didn't want to follow this route. Unexpectedly, it was photography that saved me from this uncertain future. We see some images of Rodrigo, very 2 years old, very angelical looking, which he hasn't kept, I must say. Another one with his mother, with his sister Columbia, who later on became a very well-known dancer in the military college. Doing some mountaineering, which doesn't look too strenuous. This is on the outskirts of Mexico City, a place called El Ajusco, the very highest part. 4,000 meters, but you were resting, so it's okay. showing how agile he is. This was a lunch we had with Garcia Marquez in the early 80s. We saw him and Mercedes now and again, but not very often because he was traveling so much and meeting statesmen like Mitterrand, and we were just, you know, folks at home kind of thing. But we saw him now and again. This was the year before he died, at his home in San Angel, the Pedregal de San Angel. This was taken a few years later, but as you can see, Rodrigo still had this like thirst for action, and the guys on this petroleum tower, the excavation tower, wouldn't let him go up, but he got up there, and that's his feet at the bottom. Anything that was dangerous, he was in it. He's still in it. He still likes climbing trees. This is the tower. Okay, next part.
Me inicié en la fotografía de prensa a los 20 años de edad en el semanario Impacto de la Ciudad de México. Fui desde 1964 asistente y cargacámaras del fotógrafo colombiano Guillermo Angulo, quien era jefe de fotografía de esa publicación. Con él aprendí el oficio metódicamente, con asombro constante y facilidad debido a mis estudios técnicos previos.
I began as a press photographer when I was 20 in the weekly magazine Impacto in Mexico City. Since 1954, I'd been the assistant and camera carrier for the Colombian photographer Guillermo Angulo, who was the chief of photography for this publication. With him, I learnt the trade methodically, with constant amazement and also ability due to my previous studies.
Este maestro era un hombre joven de amplia cultura, que me transmitió con celo y dedicación de maestro renacentista los principios técnicos básicos del oficio, además de inculcarme el interés por cuestiones sociales y políticas y el transcurso de la historia contemporánea.
This teacher was young and with a broad cultural knowledge, and who transmitted with the care and dedication of a Renaissance master the basic technical principles of the profession, as well as provoking my interest in social questions and in the course of contemporary history.
En aquel entonces no había, ni en sueños, escuelas de fotografía y menos cursos de ellas en los ámbitos de la enseñanza media o superior. Los fotógrafos de prensa normalmente nos formábamos como ayudantes en periódicos o revistas y algunos en estudios fotográficos de donde emigraban a la supuesta emoción del periodismo gráfico.
At this time, there were no photography schools and even less courses at the middle or senior high school level. Press photographers generally began as assistants in newspapers or magazines and some in photographic studios, but later to go on to journalism looking for more supposed emotion.
Puedo decir que mi desarrollo como fotógrafo corrió parejo con mi toma de conciencia de los problemas del mundo, especialmente en Latinoamérica. En 1955, recién cumplido los 21 años, mi mentor se fue a Italia a estudiar cine en Cinecittà.
I can say that my development as a photographer ran on a par with my awareness of problems in the world, especially those in Latin America. In 1955, when I just turned 21, my mentor went to Italy to study cinema. So we see some images from this group. He was one of Rodrigo's first jobs working with Guillermo Angulo on the left. They had to do some kind of underwater shots. They didn't have a clue how to dive, how to use the apparatus, and Guillermo Angulo couldn't even swim. So heaven knows how that shot turned out. This is Guillermo, who today, even today, we have very close contact with him. He's a very dear friend. With the Portuguese art critic and writer, Antonio Rodriguez. Rodrigo in the door of his first dark room with a human skull on the door and some folkloric mask above it. Up a post, as usual. Okay, beginnings.
Poco tiempo después, adquirí la planta en impacto, donde en noviembre de 1956 gané mi primera portada y el reportaje central. Las órdenes diarias de trabajo eran para mí insignificantes y aburridas, como por ejemplo, desde bautizos hasta matrimonios de los hijos de políticos y las crónicas infaltables de las actividades del Estado mexicano, que controlaba absolutamente todos los medios de prensa y la naciente televisión.
Not long after, I was given a permanent place in Impacto, where in November 1956, I gained my first cover and center article. The daily work orders were for me insignificant or just plain boring. For example, from baptisms to the weddings of politicians' children, and also the always present activities of the government, who controlled absolutely all the press and emergent television.
En este medio me sentí frustrado y atado de manos. Sin embargo, ahí conocí a muchos periodistas notables, escritores y artistas, todos ellos de ideas liberales, que contribuyeron también a mi formación ideológica y artística.
In this medium, I felt very frustrated and with my hands tied. Nevertheless, I met many notable journalists, writers and artists, all with liberal ideas that contributed to my ideological and artistic formation.
Otra influencia fundamental fueron las revistas norteamericanas especializadas en fotografía, como también las siempre esperadas Life, Paris Match, Do, y mi aproximación por ellas a grandes fotógrafos como Walker Evans, Edward Haim, Eugene Smith, Ansel Adams, Cartier-Bresson y muchísimos más. En México aprecié sobre todo a Nacho López y tangencialmente a Manuel Álvarez Bravo.
Another fundamental influence were the American magazines specializing in photography. Also the keenly awaited Life, Paris Match, and Do, and my awareness through them of great photographers such as Walker Evans, Louis Hine, Eugene Smith, Ansel Adams, and Cartier-Bresson. In Mexico, especially, Ignacio Lopez, and incidentally, Manuel Alvarez Bravo. Okay. This was the first cover that he got, Gloria Rios. And the text below says, doing an epileptic rock and roll. So this was a big deal for him to have his first cover and feature article. Typing under a leaky roof. Whoops, sorry. Very clean cut. Young guy. This is interesting because also on the background you see Reformer, which some of you may know. At that time, very few cars, just a few lanes of traffic. Today, it's a different city. Taking shots in the country, Tepoztlan. This is interesting. He was interviewing braceros, agricultural workers who were later to go to the United States, in an area called the Ciudadela, in the historic center. And where they went to work on the legal papers. I don't know if it was a green card, some kind of certificate. And there's a note on the door at the side that says, no intermediaries and it's free. But that was just words. Because all around there were what they called coyotes. As Rodrigo says, predatory coyotes, who helped them work on their papers. Of course, they charged them for it. Some of them were decent people, and because a lot of the workers, the braceros, they didn't even speak English, and they helped with the papers. But there were also false coyotes, who took their money and just disappeared. Even though at that time it was permissible, you know, to cross the border, and some went, as they say, wetbacks, because they just couldn't manage this kind of process.
Look at my shoe.
Oh, his shoes. He says, look at my shoes. Yeah. So, The braceros are pretty well dressed. They've got strong boots and everything. And Rodrigo's shoes have got holes in them. Because he used to walk so much. He didn't have a car. And this is partly why he has so many shots of people in the streets, ordinary, everyday folk, because he walked everywhere. And when you're going by somewhere in a car, you don't see half what's going on. So he kept fit too. Part of this series of like intellectuals, artists, Jose Luis Cuevas, always being very current, very original, with extravagant, as Rodrigo says, with chicken's feet in his hands. We don't know what that meant. Colton Beals, a well-known American writer and journalist at that time. Carlos Fuentes. Mariana Yampolsky, before she was really working as a photographer, this was in the Taller Gráfica Popular. She worked a lot of engravings. At that time, the director of this taller was Pablo Higgins, who'd left the States, American painter, who'd left the States because of the prevalent McCarthyism of that time. Renato Leduc, a well-known journalist and writer, and David Alfaro Siqueiros, painting in the Tallera, where he made a series of murals. Okay.
La mediocridad y la monotonía del ambiente me orilló a abandonar la revista Impacto y buscar otros horizontes. Hice mucha fotografía de danza y teatro, ilustraciones para libros y folletos, así como reproducción de arte y retratos, tanto de hombres y mujeres notables, como de personajes anónimos tomados al paso en la calle, en pueblos, durante su trabajo.
The mediocrity and monotony of the journalistic atmosphere led me to abandon Impacto and look for different horizons. I did a lot of work in dance and theater, book illustration, magazines, art reproduction, and portraits, equally of well-known men and women, as well as the anonymous, taken when I was walking casually in the street, in country towns, or when they were at work.
Fotografié en dos ocasiones en mi propia casa a Gabriel García Márquez, en circunstancias muy especiales. Una de ellas fue en 1976 para documentar el ojo morado que le dejó un fuerte derechazo del también escritor y premio Nobel Mario Vargas Llosa.
On two occasions at my home, I photographed Gabriel García Márquez in very special circumstances. One was in 1976 to document the black eye that a powerful right hook that the writer and also Nobel Prize winner Mario Vargas Llosa gave him.
En 1960 fui contratado por el Instituto Nacional de Antropología e Historia para documentar zonas arqueológicas, arquitectura y pintura colonial en distintos rumbos del país. Fue un trabajo muy bello que me dio mucha independencia y me enseñó de cerca el prodigioso patrimonio cultural de México.
In 1960, I was contracted by the National Institute of Anthropology, INA, to document archaeological zones, architecture, and colonial painting in different parts of the country. It was a lovely job, which gave me great independence and showed me from close up Mexico's prodigious cultural patrimony. Here are some photos of folkloric dancing, contemporary dancing, theater. He has a real big archive of theater, different shows, plays. Rita Macedo, who was later to become Carlos Fuentes' wife. Dolores del Río, getting dressed for a role in Lady Windermere's Fan. Juan Soriano, well-known Mexican painter. Fanny Cano, she has a portrait here, looking very voluptuous. This is a bit more discreet, but I really like this photo because of it shows how the people of that class lived at that time. She was a well-known actress, and you can see the furniture and her fur coat and what have you, very coquettish. Diego Rivera and Siqueiros. This was an interview Rodrigo had very early on in his career. He had to go and interview these two colossus of Mexican mural painting who couldn't stand the sight of each other. And for political differences, and he couldn't get them to even shake hands or to say anything. And at the end of about 10 minutes, Diego said, basta. And that was it. So his article was a bit, I think, not very good.
Only 8 photographs, no more.
Only 8 shots.
Basta, sorry, Diego Rivera. Diles que Diego Rivera ya venía muerto de...
Yeah, he'd, at that time, Diego had just come from the Soviet Union. He'd undergone cobalt treatment for cancer, and he was dying. So, well, he didn't have to make any concessions politically to anybody, but he was, you know, he had his own political point of view, and Siqueiros had his. Maria Felix, with the painting behind, is by Diego. Here's a contact sheet of the Black Eye series. Some of the shots. This is... I don't think he was too worried about it. You can see he, you know, he was quite okay.
Y que fue la única sonrisa que pude sacarle porque en todas sale con una cara muy trágica.
Yeah, in the other shots he has a very tragic face, but here he was smiling. There's quite a story behind why Vargas Llosa gave him the black eye. They were in a cinema in Mexico City, and they'd been very old friends from Paris days. And Garcia Marquez went towards Mario to give him a hug, and he was met with this right hook. And the reasons behind it are kind of shrouded in mystery and like discreetness. People don't like to delve into it too much. It was something between them and a certain situation. these are some of the shots that he took for the cover of the first English edition of 100 Years of Solitude by Penguin Books. The actual very first edition, I think, was printed in Buenos Aires. Is that true? The primer edition
in Buenos Aires. Yeah.
Yeah, and they used another cover, but this was the one of the shots was for the Penguin edition. Archaeological images. This is Tula, Teotihuacan, Palenque when it was being more or less unearthed. Rodrigo took a lot of shots of frescoes and sculptures. This is Uxmal or Mitla?
Uxmal.
And Mitla. Tourists in Mitla. We haven't decided if they're American tourists or Spanish tourists, because the guy is wearing alpargatas, which isn't very usual for Americans to use. But it's a nice shot. This is the sotocoro of the church at Tlacochowaya. I could say it.
Oaxaca.
See? In Oaxaca. It's a beautifully painted church on the outskirts of Oaxaca. And this is a roof detail of Santo Domingo, also in Oaxaca. So these were part of that series.
Después de este paréntesis de tres años entre pirámides y catedrales, pero siempre fotografiando al paso escenas, gentes, casas, en 1964 volví al periodismo, esta vez como jefe de fotografía de la revista Sucesos. Allí, al fin, pude desarrollar lo que considero el corazón de la fotografía documental, el reportaje gráfico.
After this interval of 3 years between pyramids and cathedrals, but always photographing the local people, their homes and backgrounds, in 1964 I returned to journalism, but this time as chief photographer at the magazine Sucesos. There, at last, I could develop and work on what I consider the heart of documentary photography, the photographic report.
En este género fundamental, pude aplicar mi visión personal del mundo y mi simbología fotográfica. Si la foto documental es la madre de todas las fotografías, su hija predilecta es el reportaje gráfico. La falta de miras de las empresas periodísticas impedían realizarlo. Un periodismo subdesarrollado estaba lejos de los grandes medios de los países con grandes tirajes y millones de lectores.
In this fundamental genre, I could apply my personal vision of the world, my photographic symbols. If documentary photography is the mother of all photography, Then her favorite son is the photographic report or essay. In Mexico, it was impossible to realize in-depth features due to the insular vision of the newspaper business. This constrained journalism was far from the big mass media of the wealthy countries, with their large print runs and millions of readers.
Sin embargo, en sucesos y ya conociendo la mecánica de los procesos editoriales, pude dar salida a mis puntos de vista y sugerir o imponer en mis trabajos las fotos que yo elegía. En esos casi 4 años estuve en libertad para escoger mis temas e intervenir en los procesos de diseño.
However, in sucesos, already understanding the mechanic of editorial processes, I could give vent to my viewpoints and suggest or impose the images in my work. During these almost 4 years, I had the liberty to choose my themes and also intervene in the design process. Sucesos portrait with Siqueiros.
Mi respuesta.
A poor barrio, no, a district Obrero. In Mexico City. For me, very reminiscent of the post-war years in the north of England. It has that same feel about it. Whooping cough, this photo. Rodrigo just went into the room there and asked the lady if he could take a photo, and this was the scene. And the children were on the floor, and that was it. Lectura basura, we call this one. Entre adobes, living in adobe bricks. This one is quite funny. Apart from the design of the announcement for it, everybody looks so serious, and they really feel they're going to see a serpent lady inside there, because they just expect that. Rodrigo says it was a play with mirrors. I didn't know. I thought they maybe dressed somebody up in a costume, but he said they did a play with mirrors to show the serpent lady. This one's called Chemise. This is also reminiscent of two photos, one by Nacho Lopez of a young woman called Mati Huitron, who is very curvy, and all the guys in the street looking after her. And also one by Ruth Orkin, an American girl in Rome. It was taken in Rome. But also what Rodrigo calls provoked action. Well, in these two cases, these two examples, the action was provoked to take the photo to see the guys looking at the girl. But this was just natural. Even though she seems very straight-laced kind of lady, well, she got her look. This area was a kind of labyrinth of what we call a vecindad, a very poor area where people lived. Very, very labyrinthic. And it was called Casablanca. I don't know why Casablanca, nothing to do with your Casablanca. And it was the area where Oscar Lewis based Los Hijos de Sanchez, the Sons of Sanchez. He based it on this particular vecindad.
Libro de gran éxito.
Yeah.
Millones.
A market scene. Also, like folkloric, popular art.
Una sirenita asustada.
You call it the curious mermaid. Very curious. You won't see this kind of scene nowadays, really. The pot seller on the street. And this was in the country. This has a counterpoint with the zigzag and the people in pairs. And these guys just walking along the street like, well, that's every day. kind of costume. Jerónimo, this is the full-length portrait of him, and in the exhibition you can see a close-up of him. Rodrigo's written about this meeting with Jerónimo, who really struck him. He was very dignified, and they had a nice talk. He said he only collected rubbish from the very smart areas. He didn't collect just any rubbish. And this was, if anyone who knows Mexico City, taken in the Las Lomas area, which is like Dallas, more or less. Very wealthy area. Social movements of the teachers' union, Mexico City. Here, this shot, you think, well, they're all beating up on this teacher, but the granadero, who's towards the front, is really saying, leave him, leave him. He's trying to stop this action. And it looks as if he's part of it, but that wasn't the case. These were fathers and mothers protesting on behalf of the teachers who are on strike. Okay.
¿Me voy?
Feature.
El reportaje. Mm-hmm. A principios de los años 60 se habían abierto algunas fisuras en la información, tal vez como respuesta al descontento político y al reciente autoritarismo y dependencia del exterior. En Sucesos se aprovecharon esas circunstancias y se dio cabida a artículos y reportajes críticos sobre las muchas caras escondidas del otro México, un país sumergido en graves contradicciones, sin contrapesos de oposición y con la injusticia social visible por doquier.
At the beginning of the 60s, some fissures were opened regarding information, possibly as a reply to public discontent of the growing repression and dependence on the exterior. These circumstances were taken advantage of in Sucesos and opened the way to critical and questioning articles on the many unknown facets of the other Mexico, a country submerged in grave contradictions, without the counterweight of political opposition and social injustice visible everywhere.
En esa coyuntura fue que publiqué imágenes y reportajes, muchas veces con mis propios textos, que antes eran impensables. La Revolución Cubana había cambiado el panorama político de Latinoamérica y la juventud exigía nuevas noticias y un nuevo periodismo crítico y menos servil.
These circumstances enabled me to publish images and articles, often with my own text, which previously would have been unthinkable. The Cuban Revolution had changed the political panorama in Latin America, and the youth demanded a new journalism, critical and less servile.
Creo que estaba ganando, llegando a una cierta madurez como fotoperiodista. Yo mismo imprimía en largas sesiones nocturnas en el laboratorio fotográfico instalado en mi propia casa. Entre los testimonios y reportajes que capté, destacan los realizados sobre las zonas desérticas del norte de Coahuila, donde podemos ver la pobreza y la vida precaria de los isleros, lo mismo que en el mezquital en el estado de Hidalgo.
I felt that I was arriving at a certain maturity as a photojournalist and was printing in long night sessions in the laboratory I'd installed in my home. Amongst the many testimonials and articles that I captured stand out those realized in the desertic north of Coahuila, where we can see the poverty and precarious life of the Ixtleros, and similar scenes in the Mezquital in the state of Hidalgo.
Me fue posible viajar por Latinoamérica y cubrir situaciones políticamente críticas. Así, estuve en Panamá y en 1965 en la República Dominicana, donde pude infiltrarme y captar a través de mis lentes la invasión armada de los Estados Unidos, donde fui testigo de la desigual batalla entre marines y rebeldes en la capital de Santo Domingo.
It was possible for me to travel in Latin America and cover politically critical situations. In this way, I was in Panama and in 1965, the Dominican Republic, where I could infiltrate and through my lenses capture the armed invasion of the United States and was a witness to the unequal battle between Marines and rebels in the capital of Santo Domingo.
Viví situaciones difíciles en Venezuela y Guatemala, fotografiando desde dentro aspectos de las rebeliones armadas que por aquellos años sacudían a varios países latinoamericanos. En 1964 viajé a Cuba, donde tuve la suerte de lograr una entrevista con el Che Guevara que duró más de 2 horas. Se dio en el penúltimo día de nuestra estancia en la isla y por la falta de material fotográfico solo pude hacer 19 tomas.
I also experienced difficult situations in Venezuela and Guatemala, working from the inside on aspects of the armed rebellions that shook various countries in Latin America. In 1964, I traveled to Cuba, where I had the luck to obtain an interview with Che Guevara, and which lasted for more than 2 hours. This occurred on the penultimate day of our stay on the island, and for the lack of photographic material, I could only shoot 19 frames. Another cover in the Ixtlero region. El Ixtle es hambre. These people lived so, so poorly, and it was a really hard life. And Rodrigo wrote many of the articles. Photos, the text was by Froilán Manjares, yeah. Ixtle family. This is called sombrita, like a little shadow. This photo, I think, has the most poetic title of all the exhibition and any photo of Rodrigo. It's called, in Spanish, Bebiendo Nubes, or Drinking Clouds. This was in the Mezquital area, Hidalgo. Again, you can see poverty, you could be in Africa, you could be anywhere. You can see this even today. Things haven't changed very much at all. Yeah. Mezquital, Santo Domingo, el cuartel de
Osama.
You can see there's a helmet on the floor and there's blood being lost there.
Las huellas de un francotirador, el casco perforado.
Yeah, este lo dije. Young boy with the tank. This is quite funny because Rodrigo was taking this wall. He was just shooting the bullet holes on the wall, and people were walking by, and these three ladies just stopped, and they posed. Some people even have thought they were prostitutes. I don't know why. I think they were just ordinary secretaries. But they just stopped and they posed by themselves. Yeah, it was a decisive moment, really. Very natural. So Rodrigo took them. This is him in the jungle in Venezuela with gorillas. The very iconic photograph of gorillas in the mist. Also this, they just grouped together there. The light suddenly changed. It had been pretty dark. And then there was a break in the clouds and the mist. And Rodrigo liked the light conditions. He was very tired, but he said, "Oh, let me take a shot of you." And they just put themselves like that, and quickly he took the shot. Other gorillas in Guatemala, you can see they're bathing, but they don't keep their eyes off what's happening around them. They keep their guns nearby them. This is in Cuba. They call her the Cuban Marilyn, for obvious reasons. Also in Cuba, where the very opulent buildings were taken and used by the state for schools, or in this case, a ballet school. Che contact sheet, one of the contact sheets, and one of the shots. They were supposedly only going to have 15 minutes for this interview with the Che, which came about because the Chilean government had broken relations with Cuba that same day. And so it opened up a window in Che's time frame where Rodrigo and two other friends, who one was a caricaturist and the other one was a reporter, they could go in and interview Che. And the first thing Che said, who was the caricaturist, which was Rios, because he really liked his work. And Rios said, he was very nervous at meeting Che. But this was in difficult light conditions, there were Persian blinds behind, and Rodrigo just set up his camera in front of Che and just took his 19 frames. He couldn't do much more under these circumstances. Do you want to add anything? Mm-hmm. ¿Quieres añadir algo? Mm-hmm. ¿Qué que dije
todo? No, está bien. ¿No?
Refuge.
Terminando estos periplos que me permitieron ensamblar reportajes críticos, la censura silenciosa volvió a caer sobre la prensa mexicana. Otra vez, lo urgente era difundir los eventos gubernamentales.
At the end of these trips, which allowed me to assemble critical articles, the silent censorship once more fell over the Mexican press. Yet again, the emphasis was on government events.
Así, emprendí mi última fuga del periodismo y me refugié en la desmesura de fundar en 1968 una pequeña empresa editorial que durante 21 años publicó mensualmente una revista dedicada a la pesca y al trabajo de los hombres del mar.
In this way, I undertook my last flight from photojournalism and in 1968 took refuge in the risky undertaking of founding a small publishing business, which for 21 years brought out a magazine dedicated to fishing and the men of the sea.
Aunque seguía fotografiando para ilustrar la revista, ya no lo hacía con el mismo fervor de los años anteriores. Sin embargo, tomé tantos miles de fotos que algunas trascienden la ilustración y en conjunto forman otro archivo que nos sigue dando sorpresas a Susan y a mí.
Chapter. Although I was still using my camera to illustrate the magazine, it was no longer with the same fervor of the previous years. Nevertheless, I took thousands of shots, some of which transcended mere illustration, and as a body of work formed a separate archive which still surprises Susan and myself. These are some magazine covers which I illustrated at that time. We were working together. We weren't a couple, but I lived in the country and he lived in Mexico City, and there wasn't even any messenger services at that time. I used to send them in by plane, and it was difficult, but it was fun. This is a shot I really like. This was taken in the market, the fish market in Mexico City, La Viga. Basket of huachinangos, of which I think Edward Weston has a similar kind of shot. Marlin going home on a bike. This is called Espejo de Arena. You can see the figures silhouetted in the sand. Sometimes I had this one way and the other way, and I think, what's the right way up? Can't get it. This is actually a photo by Tina Modotti with campesinos reading El Machete. I don't know the date of it, but I put it in because Rodrigo has a similar kind of shot, where they're fishermen and they're reading his magazine. Of course, at the time, he didn't have Tina Modotti's photo in his mind, but later on, this is something very similar. Taking shots on a big tuna fishing vessel. He's got his camera there and looking very knowledgeable about boats, I suppose. The action man again, diving in a volcano, a very high altitude diving project. This is a curious shot. They'd been diving in the Gulf of Mexico and had brought up these amphoras from a galleon, like about 17th century. But the reason why we show it, and it's something special, the cup that Rodrigo has in his hand has a name written on it. It has the name Victor. But the guy who took it out is the guy there on the right-hand side, and he's called Victor. And he found the cup. And he still got it.
Este era Victor.
Yeah. Very, very strange. Rodrigo, working very hard as usual. So, this is the last one now.
La revista sobre mar y pesca me otorgó dos décadas de aventuras y trabajos muy interesantes. Sucumbió en una de tantas crisis económicas que siguen flagelando al mundo. La pequeña editorial vivió un lustro más, pero al final corrió la misma suerte que la revista, sin recursos económicos para sumarme a las nuevas tecnologías. Así las cosas, Susan y yo decidimos emigrar de la capital y refugiarnos en Cuernavaca, a 70 kilómetros del Distrito Federal.
The magazine that gave me two decades of adventures and interesting work collapsed in one of the many economic crises that are still scourging the world. The small publishing business lived for 5 more years, but without being able to modernize, finally suffered the same luck. So Susan and I decided to emigrate from the capital and seek refuge in the city of Cuernavaca, 70 kilometers away.
Y entonces, mientras ordenábamos en la nueva casa todo el pasado que llevábamos a cuestas en esa mudanza, las fotografías empezaron a emerger de cajas y sobres de negativos, reclamando atención para no caer en el olvido y el abandono.
Whilst we were getting the new house in order with everything that a huge house moving implicates, the photographs began to emerge from their boxes and the negatives in their envelopes, reclaiming attention, not wanting to be abandoned.
Eso fue en 1998, y lo que al principio era un puro afán ordenador, en poco tiempo se transformó en una recuperada pasión por la fotografía. El archivo periodístico había permanecido más de 35 años guardado, y calculo que era apenas un 60 o 65% de lo que tomé en mi vida de fotógrafo activo. Las imágenes fueron renaciendo, mostrándome sus rostros antes ignorados o no vistos.
This was in 1998. And what at the beginning was a pure effort to put things in order after a short time was transformed in a renewed passion for photography. The journalistic archive had been carefully stored for more than 30 years, which I calculate consisted of 60 to 60% of what I'd taken in my active photographic life. The images started emerging, showing faces before ignored or hardly seen.
En el año 2002, presenté la primera exhibición personal en mi vida, acertadamente llamada por Susana, Fuera de Moda, que itineró por 5 ciudades del país. Pero después, Susan abandonó sus trabajos de diseño e ilustración y se unió a mi exploración en este laberinto de imágenes que aún no termina de entregarnos todos sus secretos, parte de los cuales ustedes verán en esta presentación y en el libro maravilloso hecho conjuntamente por la Universidad de Texas Press y The Wittliff Collections. Muchas gracias por su paciencia.
A little bit. In 2002, I presented the first individual exhibition in my life, aptly called Fuera de Moda, out of fashion. Because we said, well, he's out of fashion now, he's not digital, so it was out of fashion. But it had a big success, really, and which itinerated to 5 cities in the country. Shortly after, Susan abandoned her design and illustration work and joined in my exploration of this labyrinth of images that still hasn't given up all its secrets, some of which you can see in this exhibition and in the book, so carefully and beautifully made by the Wittliff Collections and the University of Texas Press. Thank you to everyone for your patience.